Now, that's something I'm really glad to hear, because you haven't changed.
Yeah.
Okay, let me
too late to start changing horses.
Let me just do a little intro, and we'll just get on with it, if that's okay with you, sir.
Cool.
Okay. I am very pleased and very proud to welcome onto the program Mr. Gino Washington, legend. Should I say British soul legend or just soul legend? Because, Gino, you really sort of came to prominence in the UK, didn't you?
Yeah, I just love everything about it.
Now, I mean, you were in the USAF, the American Air Force, and you were stationed in East Anglia, I think it was. And you were gigging around London in about 1965, is that right?
Yeah, no, I started in the Air Force, just happened by accident, and I started singing in pubs with the local band. I was in the American Air Force at RAF Bentwaters and RAF Woodbridge. I was a PT instructor and this English guy that worked for us, he came over and he worked for us, and every weekend he'd come back on Monday and tell me what a great time he had. Booze, women, oh, everything is pate, pate, pate. I said, well, how can I get some of that action? And, you know, I started going down to the Mecca and Top Rank Ballroom, and plus singing in pubs and all of that. So before I hit London, you know what I mean, I had to learn how to sing, because I didn't know nothing about no singing. I was a dancer. You know, I could dance. And I came from an athletic background, basketball, American football, and all of that, you know. So I was an athlete, and I got over here, and it happened by accident. I'm glad. And I started off my career before I hit London down there with the local bands, and every time Rod Stewart would come, or with Long John Baldry and the Hoochie Coochie Men, and the Animals, I started off singing with them also, you know what I mean? Mm. Let me sing two songs, you know. just sitting in, friendship, we liked each other, and made a party of it, you know what I mean? So I'll stop talking so much, because I'm talking your head off.
Listen. Is it true, you say you came from, you know, you were doing physical instruction. Is it true that you actually sparred once with Muhammad Ali?
Did I once spar with Muhammad Ali? Is that what you asked me?
Yeah, that's right.
It was a comedy thing.
Ah, right.
I did spar with him, but it was comedy. We set it up, you know, jokingly. You know what I mean?
Now, I was lucky enough.
Last thing is, I would have whooped his ass if I hadn't slipped in my own blood.
Listen, I was lucky enough to be one of those people that bought and treasured Hand Clapping, Foot Stomping, Funky But Live, and Hipsters, Flipsters, and Finger Popping Daddies. What brilliant albums!
I thank you very kindly, man. I'm very fortunate, way lucky, you know, to experience such a good time. You know what I mean? It was, because it was the 60s, and it was like a revolution. Everything changed. Nobody done it the way Daddy and Mommy used to do it. Uncle George didn't know nothing about this. Yeah, man. So.
Now, I bought those albums because I saw you and the Ram Jam Band live in Birmingham, I think it was.
Get out of here, did you?
I did.
See us live?
I did.
Oh, that's great, man. That's great.
One of the things that struck me was you must be an absolute slave driver, because the way that band worked and moved and danced. But having explained you're a dance instructor, now I understand.
No, man, it was teamwork, and we was on a mission, you know what I mean? That even if nobody knew us or anything, whoever came to the gig, we was going to party and let them know that we was there, you know what I mean? Because that's what you got to do. You got to put on a show that people would follow you for the next gig, that even if they didn't know who you were or anything like that, they like the show and they like that band. So if they ever see that band around an area again, they'll come back and see them. You know what I mean? So it was teamwork, and it wasn't my band. I was just a member of it. You know what I mean? And we all worked as a team. You know, we knew it was going to be a hard journey, but we would make it enjoyable.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you know what I mean? And we because you had to put glide in your stride before you can get some loot in your suit. Willie Shakespeare.
Now, I always remember when I saw you, the one thing that really hit me was I had just walked into probably one of the best parties I've been to in years, and that energy that came from the stage that hit everybody made them want to get up and party too.
Were you
aware of that?
I don't mean that in a flash way that I was aware of it. It was, that's what I do. I can't do anything else because I'm not a singing bird. People don't come to hear me sing such wonderful melodies. I try to work it as an illusionist to get them in the mood, because really my influence of singing, of a person that I always admired, was Little Richard.
Yeah.
You see, because I came from rock and roll, you know what I mean? It's back in the 60s. 1961, I just come out of high school, you know what I mean? Mm. And joined the Air Force. But my idol was Little Richard. So I tried to, although it was soul, bring the energy level into that it has some rock and roll characteristics, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that worked for me, you know what I mean? And the rest of it, talking and bullshitting and all of that, you know, I had that already. I had to learn how to sing.
Now, there is one song of yours which I absolutely love, and I've got it on a CD, and you know, I play it in the car now, and that's Michael the Lover. I love that track.
Everywhere I go, you know, because time is changing, you know, but they come to see me, you know, and the Ram Jam Band, and so it's always like, Michael, to Michael. You know what I mean? I'm thankful for that.
That came out in 67, and it's still popular now. It's still a brilliant tune to this day.
I thank you, because a lot of times they have these, we used to call them in the all-nighters back in the day.
Yeah.
Now they call them, what they call it now? The all-nighters.
Yeah, you know, the soul parties, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's, you know what I mean? That's what it was originally back in the day, you know what I mean? I forgot what they call it now, all these people into the soul thing.
Well, the Northern Soul stuff.
That's what they call it, Northern Soul, right? But when we started that Northern Soul, not me, but the difference is, back in the day, they would hire the group, the actual live group, you see. Northern Soul, if you've seen Northern Soul, some place is putting it on, you know, ballroom, a club, or putting it on. You knew you're going to see the real groups. Well, the groups. It would be a group. It wouldn't be disco, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It was the live groups while they was alive.
And, of course, the main thing was that we in the UK hadn't seen any of those bands. So along comes Gino Washington and the Ram Jam Band, and you're doing all the stuff, you know, all the Sam and Dave tracks and people like that, and you're doing them live, and it's like, wow!
Yeah, every time they would come and visit, English fans would come up to us and say, you ever heard of Gino Washington and the Ram Jam Band?
Now, in the 80s, along comes Dexys Midnight Runners, and they did that track, Gino, and it starts off with the sound that I remember from going to your concert, Gino, Gino, Gino. That's what it was like at the beginning. How did you feel when you heard that track?
Well, I was in Los Angeles, you see, and I was working on a project with the Beach Boys, and they called me over. Also, I was into self-hypnosis. Also, and I didn't know nothing about that Gino track, so all the major newspapers in England, you know, they called me, and I was out in Los Angeles, and they said, the Dexys Midnight Runners, hold that record, it's selling like hot fire, it looks like it's going to be a number one, right, you know, how do you feel about those guys doing that? I says, I think I ought to sue them for making me look too good. No, I was joking, you know, because it went by me. It went over my head. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because I thought they was doing a recording session and had some extra time and got drunk and came up on Gino. You know, I thought they done it as a joke and stuff. You know what I mean? But I did meet Kevin Rowland. He says, no joke. It was on purpose. We done it.
Yeah.
To pay respect to you, you know what I mean? So it's a wonderful thing, and I'm just a grateful guy for that thing is happening, because it's not me doing anything and trying to do any publicity and all of that. It was just done for love, and I'm happy they had success with it.
Fantastic. Now, you mentioned there that you've studied hypnosis, but you're also an author as well, which I didn't realize.
Yeah, done that too, you know what I mean? And, you know what I mean? I got great reviews and everything, but the company I was with went out of business.
Oh, typical.
Can you piss me off?
So, Gino, you're still touring. You're still working. The band is still performing. What are you doing for the rest of the year, for 2018?
I don't know. They send me a date sheet, you know what I mean? I don't know. I glance at them, you know what I mean? So I don't know what I'm doing. Brad comes and pick me up, and we get to the gig, and it's party time.
Brilliant. Okay, look, one more question before I let you go, sir, because it's fabulous talking to you. Is it true at the beginning? I've got another one. Is it true that Peter Noon, aka Herman of Hermans and the Hermits, is your brother-in-law.
Hey, you on the case, man, because most interviews I do, they don't mention that, you know what I mean? That Peter Noone of Herman and Hermits, the lead singer, is my brother-in-law. He's the most wonderful brother-in-law a person could have. He's such a genuine, wonderful person, and I'm not saying this for because I'm Gino Washington and I'm trying to get publicity for him and all this, but people that meet him, they tell me what a wonderful guy he is. Yeah, man, it's an adventure with him. He has a great sense of humor. He's saying, because I knew him back in the 60s. He's married to my wife's sister. And the first time I ever seen him, he was lining up drunk.
No!
Yeah, man. I thought this guy is milking cookies. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I didn't know he lay down and get drunk. And he ended up becoming that same guy that I seen. Ended up becoming my brother-in-law.
Fantastic. What a story.
Yeah, man.
Gino Washington, legend, soul man. Thank you so much for talking to me. I'm going to play Michael in a moment.
Oh, great, man. That'd be great. Memories. And to all the fans that are listening to this show, hipsters, flipsters, and finger-popping daddies, lend me your ear. Hey, don't change that dial. This is the man for you.
Thank you so much, Gino. Take care, my friend. And hopefully one day we're going to see you again live, because that would be brilliant.
Hey, man, you must come along. We're a bitch, man. I got a bitching band, man. And it's teamwork. You know what I mean? Teamwork. And, man, we lay the funk on you. Wow.
Thank you so much. We'll see you soon. Okay. Take care, my friend.
Okay, I'm out. Thanks for having me on the show.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay.
Bye now.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. That was great. Thank you so much for talking with me.